Okay, so good evening all of you. Good evening Khushi, I just saw your name, no other name anyway. So good evening all of you and Khushi. Today I am going to discuss a very minor but important topic, and that is anatomy of inguinal canal. And good evening Ishita and Indragni. So it's a very minor topic but important topic. Last time actually I chose the wrong topic in half an hour. I want to discuss all the salient features of gastric cancer. Gastric cancer is a big topic. Normally I take 2.5 hours to discuss gastric cancer. So it's not possible to finish gastric cancer in half an hour. So at the end I realized that no, it's not a topic. I should take a topic which should be beneficial to all, right from first year up to the resident level. And I should be able to discuss the topic, at least that particular topic, in detail. I should make you understand the subject. So that is why, Avni, Swapnamaya, good morning, good evening, sorry. So that is why I have chosen this topic, inguinal canal anatomy, and I'll discuss brief hernia. You see, the problem is when we read, all of you must have read anatomy of inguinal canal. So, but when you read inguinal canal, you read from the book and it's a 2D thing. But inguinal canal actually is a three-dimensional structure, all live tissue are three-dimensional. So unless you see in the operation theater or you operate or you see live in a cadaver, it's very difficult to understand the basic anatomy. That is why I have chosen this particular topic. And in half an hour, we'll discuss anatomy and some salient feature. And by the end of discussion, you will realize, so you'll understand the whole topic and you will realize why you could not understand anatomy from the book itself. So let's now begin with, and this will be a two-way discussion. So I'll be asking question, you can answer. You see, because it's a good evening Nupur and Abhay, you see, you have to imagine a little bit. It's a 3D thing we are going to discuss in 2D medium, so you have to imagine some of the things. So let's start with anatomy. You see, suppose this is just a minute, my pen is not working, give me a second. So suppose this is ASIS, anterior superior iliac spine, and this is the pubic tubercle and pubic symphysis here. So we have the lower border of the external oblique as inguinal ligament, all of us know. So I am drawing this inguinal ligament with green line. This is the inguinal ligament, which is the lower border of external oblique, running from ASIS to pubic tubercle. You see, if I am moving from the abdomen towards skin, andar se bahar, we are moving from the peritoneal cavity towards skin. The first layer that we will see is parietal peritoneum, right? Now you have to be little focused, you have to remain little focus for next 10 minutes to understand what we are discussing. Don't write anything. There's no need to write. Because my diagram itself is going to become very messy. So many muscles, so it will become kind of net and you'll not understand. So there's no need to write. Just follow what I'm saying. Few points definitely you can write, but you cannot make the whole diagram. So if I'm moving from abdominal cavity towards skin, the first layer is parietal peritoneum. And in front of parietal peritoneum, we have a very thin layer of fat called preperitoneal fat. So let's say this is the peritoneum, this structure here is the peritoneum, and then we have fat in front of peritoneum. Now what structure will be anterior to the fat? The innermost layer of the abdominal wall is fascia transversalis or fascia transversalis, whatever you say. So let us say that this structure here is fascia transversalis. Well, just 1.25 centimeter above, that is half inch above mid inguinal point, we have a, I'll explain this, these terminology to you, we have a defect in fascia transversalis. So where is fascia transversalis or fascia transversalis? Peritoneum, preperitoneal fat, and then fascia transversalis. So this is mid point of inguinal ligament. Okay, listen very carefully. You see, let me first explain something to you. So this is mid point of inguinal ligament. Okay, now, so if I draw a line from ASIS to pubic tubercle, this is the inguinal ligament, the center of this ligament will be called midpoint of inguinal ligament. Simple English, midpoint of inguinal ligament. But suppose I draw a line from ASIS, to pubic symphysis here. First one was only inguinal ligament. Now I'm talking of here to here. Now the center of this point is called mid inguinal point. So there are two words. Don't confuse between the two. Mid inguinal point and mid point of inguinal ligament. So you can see the inguinal ligament is a green line. The center of green line shown by green asterisk, green cross, is midpoint of inguinal ligament. And the red point is mid inguinal point. The mid inguinal point, the red line here, we have femoral vessel. This is the point of femoral vessel. And midpoint of inguinal ligament is the point of internal ring. So, this is internal ring. We are discussing Ayush anatomy of inguinal canal to understand inguinal hernia. So this defect, which is known as deep ring or internal ring. Now 2-3 points should be very clear. Deep ring is not a defect in the muscle. It's a defect in fascia. Remember this. Deep ring is not a defect in transversus abdominis muscle or any muscle. It's a defect in fascia transversalis. And where it is? Above 1.25 centimeter above midpoint of inguinal ligament. Not above mid inguinal point. So I hope this point is clear, that deep ring is a defect in fascia transversalis. The size is about 2 centimeters bigger than the external ring, superficial ring, which is very small. And it is 1.25 centimeter above midpoint of inguinal ligament, not mid inguinal point. Okay, I am repeating again and again so that you don't commit this mistake in exam in Viva or theory or MCQ. So this is the mid inguinal point, which is from ASIS to pubic symphysis, and this is the point of femoral vessel, while midpoint of inguinal ligament is the point which is from pubic symphysis to pubic tubercle, ASIS to pubic tubercle, and this is the midpoint of inguinal ligament. Fine. So in front of fascia transversalis, which muscle do we come across? Just anterior to fascia transversalis, the muscle would be transversus abdominis muscle. Now please look at the screen carefully. I am using yellow color. The transversus abdominis is attached to only lateral one third of inguinal ligament. From here, I am using yellow color here. And or let's change the color, yellow is not visible clearly. Let's use blue color, no problem. So this is the transversus abdominis muscle, like this. Yes, in Ragini you are correct, then we get transversus abdominis. Now the important point is, because it's, as you can see in the diagram, because it is originating from lateral one third of inguinal ligament, it is not coming anterior to internal ring, rather it goes above the internal ring. Okay? It's not anterior, it is above the internal ring, and it will simply go from lateral to medial side. In front of transversus abdominis, which muscle we have? We have internal oblique. Now I'm using another color, let's use light blue color. Internal oblique, transversus is coming from lateral one third. Internal oblique comes from lateral two-third of inguinal ligament. It's attached to lateral two-third. So here, this is the internal oblique shown by light blue color. So naturally, internal oblique muscle comes anterior to internal ring. Fine? You have understood this point? So first point I told you that internal ring is a defect in fascia transversalis. Second point I told you that transversus abdominis is not anterior to internal ring. It goes above the internal ring because it comes only from the lateral one-third of the inguinal ligament. right? Internal oblique is attached to lateral two-third, so comes anterior to internal ring. Then, now listen carefully. This is the point here, I'm using red color. This is the point here, somewhat midway in their course. Both the muscle, transverse abdominis and internal oblique, they will fuse and will become conjoint tendon. Though they are not tendon, tendinous conjoint tendon, like a tendon, is only found in less than 10% rather. Some books say 6%, some say 8%, some say 10%, but roughly 6 to 10%. Rest of the cases, rest of the individuals, it is muscular. It's not tendinous, but it's called conjoint tendon. So here onwards, here, we have conjoint, now I'm using another color, let's use this kind of light pink color. So a violet you can say, so here this is the conjoint tendon. Basically conjoint tendon is fused internal oblique and transverse abdominis. So let's use blue color because we are using blue color for the muscle here. So this is the conjoint tendon, fine. Now anterior to internal oblique, which muscle do we see? Now we see external oblique. I'm using brown color for this. External oblique will run like this, and the just superolateral to pubic tubercle, there is a defect here, a triangular defect, this defect here. This triangular defect is, though it's called ring, but it's a triangular defect. This is the superficial ring or external ring of the inguinal canal. So this is the superficial ring, which is triangular, having a medial crural fiber and a lateral crural fiber, and in between some intercrural fiber, which is anatomy not related to hernia. So it's a triangular defect where it is just superolateral to pubic tubercle. Superolateral to pubic tubercle. And this is not working. Just give me a second. Superolateral to pubic tubercle. And this is superficial ring. Now comes the 3D problem. जो कि आप सिर्फ देख के समझ सकते हो या इमेजिन करके समझ सकते हो. देखो अब आप थोड़ा मेरी तरफ देखो. सो लेट्स फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड इंग्वाइनल कनाल, फिर मैं आपको समझाता हूं. नाउ दिस इज द वेसल मेड इंग्वाइनल पॉइंट फॉर फीमोरल वेसल एंड मेड पॉइंट ऑफ इंग्वाइनल लिगामेंट. अबव दिस इज इंटरनल रिंग. ओके, सो दिस इज द इंटरनल रिंग. वेयर इज द डिफेक्ट ऑफ इंटरनल रिंग? Fascia transversalis. This is the external ring. This defect is in external oblique epidermis, and this is the inguinal canal. What is the length of inguinal canal? Roughly 3.75 centimeter, but safely you can say 4 centimeter. Make it a round figure, 4 centimeter. Now, and what do we have this in this inguinal canal? We have spermatic cord going like this. This is the spermatic cord going to the testis, supplying. So what do we have in a spermatic cord? Well, we have, sorry, what has opened here? We have spermatic vessel, testicular artery, gonadal artery, whatever you say. We have tympaniform plexus, we have lymphatics, we have genital branches, genital nerve, etc., etc. Now you look at me. Ab aap samjhoge main kya kehne wala hu. Now this is the 3D part, so you have to focus, you have to look at me and listen carefully. Dekho. Now, suppose this is the inguinal canal. This whole pubis is the inguinal canal. Fine. This is the internal ring and this is the external ring. So which layer is this? It's a layer of fascia transversalis. Okay, here. And which layer is this? This is external oblique aponeurosis. External oblique muscle. Sorry, not remember. Muscle. So fascia and external oblique. We do have two muscle in between fascia and external oblique. Which two muscle? Transverse abdominis and internal oblique. Theek? No problem. Now, the inguinal canal, which is opening behind these two muscle, is ending in front of these two muscle. Inguinal canal, internal ring is behind internal oblique and transverse abdominis, while external ring is in front. So there is no defect, no hole in these two muscles. तो इस मसल के थ्रू पीछे से आगे तक कैसे जाती है? Now you have to listen carefully. देखो, this is inguinal canal for me, right side. This is fascia transversalis. Now the transverse abdominis muscle will go above the internal ring. It will not come in front. It doesn't come in front. It will go above till this point. An internal oblique will be anterior, like this, anterior. Now at this point, both will fuse, form conjoint tendon. This conjoint tendon will go behind the inguinal canal and will insert at pubic tubercle. It means in the lateral part of inguinal canal, the internal oblique is having anterior dilation, anterior. While in the medial part of inguinal canal, it has gone behind, forming the conjoint tendon. So we have an arching fiber of conjoint tendon forming the roof of the inguinal canal. In the lateral part, they are anterior. In the medial part, it is behind. So transverse abdominis is not having anterior dilation. It's going above the internal ring. Internal oblique going anterior to the inguinal canal. Now here it will fuse, form conjoint tendon. That's why in some of the MCQ, one of the MCQ of Ames, true, false, there's a line that internal oblique forms the anterior and posterior relation of the inguinal canal, and that's the right statement. So it is anterior in the lateral half and posterior in the medial half. I hope you have understood this point. So I'll repeat. This is the internal ring, which is a defect in fascia transversalis, and this is the external ring, which is a defect in external oblique. Transverse abdominis will go above the internal ring. Internal oblique will go anterior to the lateral half of inguinal canal. Here they'll fuse and form conjoint tendon. Then they will go behind the inguinal canal and will insert at the pubic tubercle. Iska kya matlab hua? Conjoint tendon forms the floor, the base. The base iske piche relation mein aata hai, behind the canal. Inguinal. It means I can use conjoint tendon to repair, to strengthen the floor. When I'll discuss surgery, of course we'll not discuss surgery today, but in surgery, in Bessonese repair, Schulteis repair, or any herniography, what you do? Repair the floor of the, how do you repair the floor? By using conjoint tendon and fascia transversalis. So I hope, unless you understand the anatomy, you not understand surgery. So you have to understand physiology, pathology for medicine, anatomy for surgery, and pharmacology everywhere. So I guess you have understood this point. If not, then tell me. Now I'll tell you another anatomy point. You see, so let me get up again and stand up again and explain one point. You see, the same muscle, what do we have here? Fascia transversalis, transverse abdominis, internal oblique and external oblique. The same muscle will extend along the spermatic cord, forming the layers of the spermatic cord. What are the layers of the spermatic cord? Well, external spermatic fascia, of course skin and then cremaster. So external spermatic fascia, internal spermatic fascia, and cremaster muscle fiber, internal spermatic fascia. So it is a continuity of what? Which is continuous? Now only, which I'll show you a diagram, I'll explain. The only important point you have to understand is that transverse abdominis muscle does not come in front of the internal ring. It goes above, so it does not extend downward. What is going down? The external spermatic fascia is continuity of external oblique muscle. Then we have continuity of internal oblique. And then we have continuity of fascia transversalis. There is no transverse abdominis going down because it does not come anterior or near the internal. It goes above the internal ring. Okay, which I'll show a diagram. I'll explain again. Okay, so yeah, internal oblique ishita in the lateral part is anterior. Then here it formed the, see my hand, it's anterior. Here it forms the conjoint tendon by fusing with transverse abdominis. Then it becomes posterior. It will form the arching fiber conjoint and go posterior like this. So here it is anterior and here it is posterior. Okay? Now let's see some diagram. Aur fir hum wapas aate hain hernia pe. देखो दिस ये एसी चला दो यार बहुत गर्मी है So this room is very hot, outside very cold. Yes. So you see, this is a diagram to show you the difference between midpoint of inguinal ligament and mid-inguinal point. From ASIS to pubic tubercle, this is the mid-inguinal point here, and this I told you is the point of femoral vessel. And midpoint of inguinal ligament is the point 1.25 centimeter above this we have internal ring. So this point is clear. Now, this is the inguinal canal running from internal ring to external ring, having a length of about 4 centimeter. A deep ring is a defect in fascia transversalis, and external ring is a defect in external oblique muscle. Deep ring is circular, external ring is triangular. Theek hai, ye bhi samajh mein aa gaya, no problem. Now look at this screen here. The first figure is basically external oblique fiber here forming the external ring, and you can see we have cord going like this. Now when we remove the, now we have removed the external oblique muscle. Which muscle we have? This is the internal oblique. We will have transverse abdominis behind this. The internal ring is here. Okay, let me use black color. Internal ring is here. And the cord is going like this. So this part, internal oblique, is anterior to the canal. Fine? See the black line drawn by me. And behind this would be the transverse abdominis. Transverse abdominis will not come anterior. It will go like this from here. Like this is the transverse abdominis. And here they form the conjoint tendon. It will go behind the canal. So this part is having posterior relation. This part is having anterior. I hope you are following what I am saying. Okay. So you have understood this. Good. Ab hum aate hain hernia pe, fir direct hernia ki baat karenge. Theek? Okay. Let's layer vagera abhi hum chhod dete hain. Fine. So you see, this is the inguinal canal having cord structure which is going towards testis. Now I am using red color again for peritoneum. Peritoneum is going like this, which gets obliterated. Tunica vaginalis, process vaginalis gets obliterated. Because of increased abdominal pressure and many more reasons, if a peritoneal pouch also comes inside this cord, then this has become a hernia. This is a sac, and for this we use the term hernia. Peritoneum is, this is indirect hernia, I'll come to direct also. Now peritoneum is also following the cord structure. What we can have inside this sac? What is this sac? Peritoneum. And what do we have inside this sac? We can, what do we have in the abdominal cavity? Omentum or bowel? So we can either have omentum, then we call it omentocele, or we have bowel, and that is called enterocele. So we can have omentum, omentocele, or we can have bowel, enterocele. Two words. And how to differentiate clinically, which is commonly asked in VIVAs, in MBBS. Omentocele, when you feel it has a doughy consistency, you might feel, though it's not always possible, but the difference, basic difference is when you, three, four differences, when you reduce the content, which is called taxis, you squeeze and you reduce the content, omentocele, the first part will go easily, but the last part will cause difficulty. It will, you won't be able to reduce the last part. While enterocele, the first part goes back easily, difficulty, but last part goes back easily. I'll repeat. In omentocele, no problem initially, problem if it's half of the omentum will go in, but then get stuck. While enterocele, other way around. Initially, it will pose difficulty, later half goes very easily. That's point number one. Point number two, you may find resonance on percussion in enterocele. I'll not write it, it's a demo class. We have a regular lecture for this. So when you percuss, you find resonance in enterocele, and you don't find, it's dull on omentocele. Point number three, when you auscultate, you can even see bowel sound. Here, bowel sound in enterocele, no bowel sound in omentocele. So I'll repeat. Vowel sound present in enterocele, on percussion it can be dull, it can be resonant, I'm sorry. And when you reduce, the enterocele goes back initially with ease, with comfortably to go back, but later part will pose difficulty. While omentocele other way around. First part will go easily, later part difficult to reduce. It's dull on percussion, no vowel sound. Second point here is, how long the sac is, we do have names for them. Like you see the red color, it is only, there's a sac in the canal, but only till the inguinal canal. It has not come out to the external ring. Now this is another sac, green color, which is long enough and coming out of the external ring. So it is outside the ring. And third, which I am using, which color shall I use? Violet color. Now it's going up to the scrotum. So we have different sizes and we have different name for this. If it is ending in the sac itself, in the canal itself, not even coming out of the external ring, then we call it bubonocele. Bubonocele, B-U-B-O-N-O. Bubonocele is the hernia where the sac ends within the canal, not coming out of the, it's coming out of the internal ring, but not from the external ring. Bubonocele. While if it comes out from the external ring, then we call it funicular. Funicular, F-U-N-I-C-U-L-E-R. And if it is going up to the scrotum, then we call it complete. So let me show you a diagram for this. You see, this is the omentocele, which is a laparoscopic view of omentum going into the hernia, and this is a enterocele, where you see the bowel is coming out. What are the differences? In enterocele, first part is difficult to reduce and later part goes in easily. It is resonant on percussion. Bowel sound can be heard and you may even see peristalsis sometimes, which is very rare, but yeah, theoretically one can see. And in omentocele, all these are absent. Now, this is bubonocele, funicular and complete. This is the internal ring, this external ring. It is ending inside the canal, not coming out external ring. This is bubonocele. It comes out external ring, this is funicular. And it goes up to the scrotum, then this is complete. Right? Well, this hernia, abhi thoda sa hi baat hai, abhi bahut cheez samajhne ko hai. This hernia actually, which is coming out from the internal ring, is an indirect hernia. What is a direct hernia? Now let's understand the anatomy again, same anatomy again. But this time I'll go from outside in. First time we'd move from inside out. Hum andar se bahar gaye the, ab bahar se andar chalenge. So let's understand anatomy again from the outside. This is ASIS. This is inguinal ligament. This is pubic tubercle and pubic bone. Now, this is the skin, what we see in front of us. We are looking from outside. You make an incision and open the skin. When you open the skin like this, now you get subcutaneous fat. And for this, we use the term camper's fascia and scarpa's fascia. You cut camper's fascia and scarpa's fascia. Which muscle you see first in front of you? External oblique muscle. This is the rectus muscle. Let's draw rectus with black color. This is the rectus muscle here. And this is external oblique drawn with brown color. This one. We have removed the fat and skin, and this is the external ring. From which this is cord structure shown by light blue color coming out. You will find one nerve here, ilioinguinal nerve. When we open the external oblique muscle, we find nerve just beneath this muscle, and that is the nerve which may get injured in hernia. Two nerves may get injured in open hernia surgery. Laparoscopic hernia, different, open hernia. First is ilioinguinal, which is just below this muscle. We will cut the muscle and you can cut the nerve. Second is genital branch of genital femoral, which will get in the cord, spermatic cord. When we dissect the cord, then we come across genital branch of genital femoral nerve. So we see the external ring in front of us. You can see cord coming out. Let's open the external ring, external oblique muscle also. So we have opened it. So you see, we have this brown line is a opened external oblique. Well, now I can see, I'm using again black color for this. External oblique, we have brown is external oblique. This is the conjoint tendon. And what is conjoint tendon? Transversus abdominis and internal oblique. Somewhere here would be the internal ring, the pink circle, and this is the cord structure going like this, the blue line. We do have an artery here, inferior epigastric artery. Now I have one question, two questions. First, inferior epigastric artery we find where? In which plane? In front of peritoneum? In front of HR transversalis? In front of conjoint tendon? Where? No, iliohypogastric nerve, we do not injure in hernia surgery. Ishita, iliohypogastric nerve gets injured in open appendix surgery. Appendix, Rutherford-Morrison incision. In hernia surgery, the two nerve injured are ilioinguinal and genital branch of genitofemoral nerve. Okay? Very good. In Ragni, you are absolutely right. The inferior epigastric artery will be in pre-peritoneal space, behind the fascia transversalis and in front of peritoneum. You are absolutely correct. Good. So, it is, Swapnama, you are also correct. It's in front of peritoneum, behind fascia. Okay. Now, my next question to you is, look at this screen. What I have done, maine apne haath se is cord ko side mein kar diya. I have taken the cord on the one side here. Now, this is the side, this is the cord. Now, my second question to you is, what is this structure where I have applied this cross? Ye kya tissue hai? Don't say Hasselbalch triangle. I am asking tissue. What tissue is this? What tissue is this? Can you tell me the name tissue? Ye structure kya hai? Jahan cross laga hua hai. Quickly. There's some lag, 20, 30 second lag, so we will waste. I'll just wait for 20 seconds, but it's wasting time actually. So, I'll answer you. This tissue is fascia transversalis. Fascia transversalis. You see, in front of fascia, we had two muscles, transversus abdominis internal oblique. They form conjoint tendon. They go like this and form the arching fiber insert at the pubic tubercle. So, yeah, good problem. This is fascia transversalis. Absolutely right. So, if I go little later, somewhere in this area here, then I'll find the muscle. But when I come in this area here, this is not muscle, this is fascia. It simply means that this is the area here where fascia has no muscle. It has external oblique. But once we remove, so there is no support of fascia by transverse abdominis or internal oblique. So this area here shown by, in Dagni you are correct, fascia it is. This area shown by the circle or in a brown circle is a weak area. And though fascia is a very, listen carefully what I am saying, fascia is a very thin and flimsy layer, but very tough structure. If I say, which is the toughest part of the abdominal wall in central area, this area, what provides strength? Not muscle, not rectus muscle, anterior rectus sheath. When we do surgery, it is mandatory to close anterior rectus sheath. Muscle I do not close, doesn't matter. But sheath I have to close, otherwise patient will develop hernia, incisional hernia. Likewise, in this part, lateral part, the toughest layer is fascia transversalis. Okay? So, this is a thin and flimsy, but a tough layer. Now, because of repeated increase in intra-abdominal pressure and many other things, it starts with old age, basically old age, weakness. It starts protruding. The whole fascia starts bulging forward because there's it's weak now, it's stretched now. And this forms here, outpouching from here, forming a hernia. Suppose the external oblique is here and this is the external ring, this green area. From where this pouch will come out? From this pouch here. So this from outside will also protrude from the external ring. But under say site alage, from where it is coming? from this weak area here. And when we have an indirect hernia, from where it is coming? Indirect hernia is coming from here. Here. This is the indirect hernia. From the internal ring, following the cord structure. And this is the orange. And you see, I'm using another color. Let's use violet color. This is a direct hernia. So from outside, both pouches, they protrude from the external ring. From inside, they're different. Indirect hernia is coming from the internal ring, from here, like this. And that's why they can go up to the scrotum. They go downward. While direct hernia is coming from here, from this weak area. And that's why they don't go downward towards scrotum. They protrude forward. They'll not go up to the base of scrotum. They protrude forward. And this weak area has a name, and this triangle is called Hasselbach's triangle, which is bounded by inferior epigastric artery, rectus muscle and inguinal ligament. So this triangle is called Hasselbach's triangle, which is formed by inferior epigastric artery on one side, rectus muscle on the medial side, and inguinal ligament inferiorly. So from here, when we have a hernia, it's a direct hernia, but when we have a hernia from this area, it's an indirect hernia. You see, what are the differences between direct and indirect? We don't have to memorize. If you have understood this much, if you have understood this much, by common sense, by residual knowledge, we can say, tell the differences. Indirect hernia is common in young age. Direct is basically weakness. It's common in old age. What about bilaterality? Which hernia is more prone for bilaterality? Direct hernia due to weakness. Abdominal pressure badhega, toh dono taraf pressure badhega. So bilateral more often direct hernia. What about the sac position to the inferior epigastric artery? Inferior epigastric artery is here. Yeah, Ragini, it's Hasselbach's triangle, correct? Inferior epigastric artery is here. So the sac of indirect hernia is lateral, while the sac is medial. Indirect hernia. Number 4. So, young age, indirect. Old age, direct. Bilateral more often, direct. The sac position to inferior epigastric artery, in indirect, it's lateral. Indirect, it's medial. Number 4. The sac of indirect will go up to the base of the scrotum. While direct, it simply protrudes out and will remain somewhat goes anterior. When you reduce, the reduction is called taxis. Even then the direction will tell you. In indirect hernia, the direction of reduction is upward and laterally. It will go laterally, obliquely. While in direct hernia, it simply goes backward. Which hernia, direct or indirect, is more prone for obstruction? Undoubtedly, indirect hernia. Why? Because the ring is, because the ring is narrower in the indirect hernia. Because the ring is narrow in the narrowest ring is in the femoral hernia. Yeah, covering is also a little different, because in indirect hernia there's no, so it's coming out from here. So we do have proper peritoneum, which comes out. While in direct hernia, it's only the fascia transversalis which comes out, rather than peritoneum. So covering is also a little different. So I was saying the narrowest ring is in the femoral ring. So femoral hernia has the highest risk of obstruction and strangulation, followed by indirect, followed by direct. Suppose an old person, 75-year-old person, having a direct hernia, and he's having so many medical comorbidity, and direct hernia is incidentally found, no problem. We don't advise surgery. We can simply keep under observation. Whenever he'll develop problem, we can operate. Most likely he'll not have problem. But in indirect hernia, we'd say, no, please plan surgery, do it electively, but get it done. It might get obstructed. And femoral hernia, we say, oh, it should be done as a semi-emergency. Definitely it'll get obstructed. So you see, the ring is important, the mouth, the opening. So obstruction chances jyada kisme honge? Indirect mein honge. Examination mein kya karte? You have to put your finger in. Finger invagination test. My finger is going in here like this. So I'll put my finger through the external. normally it's difficult to pass a finger through the external ring, but when there's a hernia, the ring is big, I can comfortably pass my finger through the ring and ask the patient to cough. Now, listen carefully and you'll understand. I'm sure many of you know this, but listen carefully. If the indirect hernia is there and patient coughs, the cough impulse will strike here. ये इंटरनल रिंग के थ्रू मेरी फिंगर चली गई टिल इंटरनल रिंग के थ्रू चली गई. नाउ द इंडायरेक्ट हर्निया विल स्ट्राइक एट द टिप, बट डायरेक्ट हर्निया इज कमिंग आउट फ्रॉम हियर, सो इट विल स्ट्राइक एट द इट्स कमिंग आउट फ्रॉम हियर स्ट्राइक एट द पल्प. आई विल ड्रॉ इट अगेन. सो दिस इज द इंग्वाइनल कनाल, दिस इज द एक्सटर्नल रिंग एंड इंटरनल रिंग. माय फिंगर इज हियर. Indirect hernia, the cough impulse is felt here, and direct hernia, the cough impulse is felt here. This is the finger insinuation test. And then you have three finger test, Zeeman test, where you use three finger to cover internal ring, external ring and femoral ring. And you can ask the patient to cough and you see in which finger the cough impulse is felt. So this we can only understand when we understand the anatomy, like what surgery we do. So you'll understand the surgery. In surgery, it's not that I'll simply put the content back and ligate the sac and this sac has come out. I have cut the sac and ligated the sac and no, this is incomplete. I have to repair this area. I have to provide strength to this area. And this is strength if I provide by tissue, local tissue, conjoint tendon, Cooper ligament, whatever tissue I have, then we call it herniorrhaphy. And when we put a ready-made substance like proline mesh or PTFE mesh, then we call it hernioplasty. But we have to provide strength to this area. Okay? And if I simply stitch conjoint tendon to inguinal ligament like this, then this, the whole area is strengthened by, with the help of conjoint tendon, then this is Bessini's repair. When I use fascia transfer salus and do double breasting, then that's called shoulder repair. So there's so many surgery, little repair, tanner slide, so many. And when you use mesh, then this is called Leichenstein repair. You use a big mesh, preperitoneal, then it's called stropa repair. So many names are there. But the basic concept is that you have to provide strength to this area. You have to provide strength to this area by local tissue, mesh, whatever. So, now you see. So, this is a Hasselbach's triangle shown in this figure. This is the inferior epigastric artery. You can see this is the inferior epigastric artery. This is the lateral border rectus and this inguinal ligament. This area is Hasselbach's triangle. So if the hernia is coming out from here, red arrow here, or let's change the color black. If the hernia is coming out from here, then this is an indirect hernia. It's coming from here. This is a direct hernia. So you, and this is an anatomy actually. This I can show. So this is an indirect hernia. Sorry, this is a direct hernia here. The arrow is showing. While the indirect hernia is coming out from the internal ring. So, the differences, I can memorize the table like most of the students they do. The problem with the medical study or medical teaching, what happens, all of you are exceptionally intelligent students. But you are made a, kind of you have to mug it up everything. Hum aap chahte hain, rat lo sab kuch. You memorize everything. So, and that really blunts your intelligence. So, you have to understand lots of things and you have to memorize less and understand more. So this whole table need not be memorized if we understand, we have understood the indirect and direct hernia differences. You see, age-wise, no, not children as such, young age indirect. Even children, congenital hernia is indirect hernia and old is direct. Pathway of protrusion, direct, it's anteriorly and indirect downward towards the scrotum. Contour sac, okay, this I can leave. Internal ring. So when you control the internal ring, indirect hernia will not appear, but direct hernia will appear because it is coming from Hasselbach's triangle. The inferior epigastric artery is, the sac is lateral indirect hernia and sac is medial indirect hernia. Obstruction in carcinogen risk is high in indirect hernia and low in direct hernia. We have one more table and it's saying almost same thing, one or two point different, but basically the same thing. Okay. So this basically is the concept of anatomy. So, and I'll come to classification and some questions after this. So in any hernia surgery, this is ASIS, this is inguinal ligament. First you open the skin, then you open the external oblique, this is the rectus muscle, then you see the internal ring, the cord is going like this, you open the cord, simple cord, and then you isolate the sac inside the cord. This is the sac cord I have taken separately, and I have separated the sac from the cord, open the sac, reduce the content. In direct hernia, there is no need to open the sac, you simply reduce, but in indirect hernia, open the sac, reduce the content, and then ligate the sac here at the neck, internal ring, I've ligated, this red color is ligated sac. Now comes the repair, and this is the conjoint tendon here. Now comes the repair part. So I can simply take conjoint tendon. Yes, yes, I'll tell you my peritoneal orifice, I'll tell you. Abhi bata raha hu. I'll tell you. Triangle of doom, triangle of pain, corona mortis and my peritoneal orifice, all four things. Just give me 5 minutes. And that, I'll discuss classification, then my peritoneal orifice, and that's it. Another 10-15 minutes. So you see, I can simply take the muscle here, conjoint tendon, and stitch it here. Then this becomes bassini repair. Herniorrhaphy, local tissue. Or I can cut the fascia transalis and strengthen the fascia by double breasting. That's shoulders. Or I can put a mesh here. That is hernioplasty, Lichenstein repair. Lichenstein repair, that's hernioplasty, mesh. And there are so many kinds of surgery. And you should know at least 7-8 surgery which we discuss normally in regular battle. Now let's come to classification. Dekho, in classification you have to know one important classification, that is NAHIS. We do have an old classification called Gilbert. Main aapko Gilbert bhi bata deta hun, but NAHIS has become more important because now we are doing laparoscopic hernia repair. So you see, Gilbert, which is a very old classification, not very important anymore. If you remember, it's okay. If you don't remember, it's still fine. It's more for theory and viva rather than MCQ. But NAHIS is important for MCQ. So Gilbert is for open hernia repair, where we have 5 types. 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. 6 and 7 were included later on. Wo bhi abhi batata hu. And it's only based on 3 things. Size of the internal ring. How big the external ring doesn't matter. Once the peritoneum comes out to internal ring, it's a hernia. So size of the internal ring. Number 2. Presence of peritoneal sac. Present or not. And number 3. Condition of fascia transversalis. How, what is the condition of fascia transversalis? Right? Good, bad, weak. So three things that we take in Gilbert: internal ring size, peritoneal sac present absent, fascia transversalis condition. 1, 2, 3 are indirect hernia and 4, 5 are direct hernia. Indirect hernia and direct hernia. Okay. Now in indirect hernia, the fascia transversalis is normal. Why? Because it's coming from the internal. Indirect hernia is weak. In type 3, it can be little weak, but generally normal. And peritoneal sac present in all 3. So actually, they're just same. The only thing that differentiates 1, 2, 3 is the size of internal ring. Less than 1 centimeter, 1 to 2 centimeter, more than 2 centimeter. That is 1, 2, 3. So internal ring, small, medium, big, type 1, 2, 3. While 4, 5, which are direct hernia, now here, the internal ring is normal, peritoneum is absent. In type 5, there is sometimes a bit of peritoneum may protrude. So fascia in 4 is weak and in 5 it is desiccated. Let's understand in detail. So 1, 2, 3, desiccated, the fibers are separated, so peritoneum may come out. And in 4, it's just weak and protruding. In 5, the fibers also separated. So 1, 2, 3 are indirect hernia. So here we only have internal rent differentiating 1, 2, 3, size less than 1 centimeter, 1 to 2 centimeter, more than 2 centimeter. Petronal sac and fascia is normal. Petronal sac is present. 4 and 5 are direct hernia. So 4 weak and 5 disc. Then we do have the new classification. They have added 6 and 7 as well. 6 is a pantaloon hernia where you have direct and indirect both. So direct plus indirect both. And 7 is femoral hernia. This was added later on, not by Gilbert. So we have 6 and 7 indirect, indirect both and femoral. Let's come to NAHES, which is important. Not only for YY and theory, NYHUS, NAHES. NYHUS, NAHES. So not only for YY and theory, even for MCQ, it's very important. It's kind of laparoscopic. When you go from inside, then you see laparoscopic. So you see, NAHES classification is type 1. So, you see, internal ring means indirect hernia and fascia or posterior wall means direct hernia. We have understood this. So in type 1, we have indirect hernia and fascia normal. So it's an indirect hernia where the ring is also normal and fascia is also normal. So it's just indirect hernia coming out from the normal size ring, kind of Gilbert 1. So here, the ring, internal ring is normal and fascia is also normal. Just indirect hernia, like congenital hernia will be type 1. There's no big ring or weak fascia. So type 2 NAHES is indirect hernia, but now the ring is wide. So it's a wide ring, but fascia is again normal. So indirect hernia and wide ring. Type 3 is a direct hernia. So what we will write in direct hernia? Weak fascia. Hernia is direct, is coming from the fascia. Weak fascia, that's a direct hernia, but normal ring. So no indirect component. This is type 3A. Type 3A. So type 1, indirect hernia, the ring is normal, fascia is normal. Type 2, indirect hernia, the ring is wide and fascia is normal. So both are indirect hernia. In 1, you have a normal ring. In 2, you have a big ring. 3A, weak fascia. So it's a direct hernia. You may have in a book posterior wall, weak fascia, weak whatever. It's a direct hernia, but again normal ring. 3B is a weak fascia. In another word, it's a direct hernia plus wide ring. What does it mean? It simply means that there's a component of indirect hernia also. And what is the name of direct plus indirect hernia? That's called pantaloon hernia, which is MCQ. So what is, in which type NAHES pantaloon hernia is kept? 3B. So 3A is only direct hernia, which is a weak fascia and normal internal ring. 3B is weak fascia and wide ring, so it's a combined. And 3C is femoral hernia. Yes, in Ragni, pantaloon means, pantaloon actually is a French word, pantalon. Pantalon ka matlab pant, English mein trouser, pant. Usi se pant word bana hai. We do have a company pantaloon which sells pant, ab to pantaloon shirt bhi banane lagi. But there's a company pantaloon only selling pant. So it's a French word, pronounced pantalon. So femoral hernia. Pant, huh? Pajama ki tarah se do bahar aage. So femoral hernia, that's C. And finally, type 4 is a recurrent hernia. Type 4A is direct, 4B is indirect, C is femoral, and D is combined. So, type 4, recurrent hernia. So, NAHES is important. You have many questions and definitely it will be asked in VIVAs and theory and MCQ. One is a simply indirect hernia with a normal ring. Two is indirect hernia with wide ring. Both fascia normal because direct component is not there. 3A is a direct hernia. So there's a weak fascia. Posterior wall is weak, but the ring is normal. 3B, weak fascia plus wide ring. So it's a combination of both. C, femoral hernia. So this is NAHES classification. Ab hum baat karte hain अब आता है लैप्रोस्कोपिक पार्ट जो सवाल, दिस इज द लास्ट पॉइंट, ठीक, ट्रायंगल ऑफ डूम, ट्रायंगल ऑफ पेन, मायोपेटियल ऑर्फिस, कोरोना वायरस, लास्ट फोर पॉइंट, देन दैट्स इट, फिर मैं एक दो एमसीक्यू बताता हूं, देखो, एंड दिस बेसिकली इज टू टेल यू दैट, देखो, इफ यू आस्क मी इफ आई हैव टू अटेंड ए लेक्चर, आई हैव टू सेंड माई सन टू ए लेक्चर, डेफिनेटली आई विल प्रेफर, और माई डॉटर, definitely I'll prefer face to face teaching, nothing to replace face to face teaching, because when I'm sitting here, aap kahan baithe, I am not even knowing whether you are following or not, aap kya kar rahe ho, aap samajh rahe ho nahi samajh rahe ho, mujhe kuch nahi pata lag raha hai, so face to face is good both way, even I can see you, you can see me, we can interact, I can make you understand the subject in a better way, when face to face is not possible, like in corona it's not possible, then second comes online live teaching. Live means you can follow me, you can ask question immediately, if you not understood anything, recorded to internet mein bhi mil jata hai na, itne sare YouTube hai recorded, you can see anywhere. So live teaching of course is not as good as face to face, but this is the second best option in the era of corona. So that's why I'm taking this lecture of anatomy of hernia, so you'll understand ki you cannot understand everything just by seeing the video. Kuch cheeze jo 3D hai, jo technical hai, jo anatomy, you have to understand By live lectures. So this is the advantage of live demo. And then of course you will get recorded also, so you can see later on. Well, so coming to Gilbert 4, 5, Nahes 3 are not really same. Gilbert 5 and Nahes 3B are same. Gilbert 5 and Nahes 3B are same. Well, so ab main kya kar raha hun? I'm going to draw a diagram to tell you a few basic things. This diagram is laparoscopic hernia repair jo hum kar rahe, and we are looking from inside, not from outside. The problem is when we do gallbladder surgery, whether I do laparoscopic open, it's same. I do hernia, I do appendix, I do uterus, the anatomy is not going to change. But in hernia, laparoscopic is from inside and open is from outside, it's totally different. The whole anatomy changes when you go from inside. Anatomy will not change, but the whole perception changes. So I'm going to draw a diagram on the right side, but main andar se bana raha hu, I'm making it from inside, so it may appear I'm making a left side, but no, it's a right side from inside laparoscopic. So this is ASIS, right side andar se dekh rahe, this is inguinal ligament, this is pubic tubercle. Let's use green color for inguinal ligament. Okay, ab this is the rectus muscle. Rectus muscle, and चलो मैं आपको एक दो पॉइंट और बताता हूं एमसीक्यू के लिए. Inguinal ligament will not end at the pubic tubercle, it will give reflections. This orange color, superior pubic ramus line, pectineal line, orange line is pectineal line. So any the fibers which are going, oh, what has happened? It has disappeared. Anyway, कुछ गायब हो गया यहां से मुझे लग रहा है. सो आई वॉज सेइंग द इंग्वाइनल लिगामेंट विल गिव रिफ्लेक्शन टुवर्ड पेक्टिनस. लुक एट द स्क्रीन, दिस, ये क्या कहते हैं रिफ्लेक्टिव फाइबर्स को, दे आर कॉल्ड लेक्यूनर लिगामेंट और गिम्बनाट्स लिगामेंट. सो दिस एरिया, दिस ब्लू एरो, लाइट ब्लू एरो इज शोइंग lacuna ligament, and any hernia through this blue dot, which hernia through which lacuna ligament, it's called Laugier hernia. We can have a hernia through lacuna ligament called Laugier hernia. So let's make the complete diagram. This is the posterior rectus sheath. I am using green color. I am sure you know that anterector sheath is complete from ziphoid sternum, ziphoid to pubic symphysis, but posterior sheath ends here, below the umbilicus, here. And this line, which again I am using violet color, this line, what is this line? This line is the lower free edge of posterior rectus sheath. I can see the rectus muscle here. This is the rectus muscle. Anteriorly, I cannot see rectus muscle because rectus sheath is completing, covering whole rectus muscle, while posteriorly, it ends above the pubic bone, pubic symphysis. So this violet line is called arcuate line. What is arcuate line? Lower border posterior cruciate. And when we have a hernia through this hernia, let's use another color, this hernia, this is called spagellian hernia. What is spagellian hernia? Spagellian hernia is through the arcuate line. Semilunar ligament yahan pe hota hai. And what is arcuate line? Lower border posterior cruciate. So you have understood, this is the inguinal ligament, this is the lacunar ligament here. Okay. Now the first layer that we get here is peritoneum. Let's say we have removed peritoneum. Now we get fascia transversalis. This is a defect in fascia transversalis, internal ring. This is the external iliac vein, which will become femoral vein once it goes below the inguinal ligament. This is the external iliac artery. And from here we have inferior epigastric artery and vein. Fine. And this is the lacunar ligament, again this green line. So this yellow thing is the fascia transversalis having a defect from inside. We are talking from inside. Okay. And this triangle here is Hasselbalch's triangle from inside. What are the boundaries? Inferior epigastric artery, rectus muscle and inguinal ligament. You can see. What is this? I am using black color. This ring here. This is the femoral ring for femoral hernia. What are the boundaries of femoral ring? Look at the screen. You can very well understand. Anterior boundary formed by inguinal ligament here, medial by lacunar ligament, lateral by femoral vein, and posterior by pectineal. This is a femoral ring. Okay. This is the pubic ramus and obturator foramen here. And this is the iliosauce. Let's make iliosauce by, this is the iliosauce here. Let's make just one line, not the whole kind of dirty. This is the iliosauce covered by peritoneum, which I am showing with violet color. So now you have understood the structures, what I have shown. I am not doing labeling. Just watch carefully. I am sure you know. This is the inguinal ligament, the black line, this one. This is the lacunar ligament, now these line, also called Gambinax ligament. I told you hernia to lacunar ligament is called Lougia hernia. This is the arcuate line here, through which we have spagellian hernia. This is the internal ring here, IR is internal ring, the origin for indirect hernia. This is the Hasselbalch's triangle, origin of direct hernia. Fine, from inside we are looking at. Now, let's see the triangle of doom and triangle of pain. Dekho, when we will apply a big mesh here, we have to do lots of dissection and a big mesh here to support this whole area and laparoscopic hernia. We have to be very, very cautious in two areas. This is the vast difference. This violet color, this is vas. This red line is testicular artery. This line. Book may say gonadal vessel, testicular vessel, spermatic vessel, they all are same. Now this triangle here, shown by black color, vas deferens here, testicular artery here, and peritoneum here. This is called triangle of doom. Why we call it triangle of doom? You can very well understand. No dissection here, no nail, no tacker, no anchor, no mesh fixation in this triangle, because in this triangle we have two very important vessels, external iliac artery and vein. They'll start bleeding. So triangle of doom ki importance kya hai? Isme do major vessels, external iliac vein and artery. And what are the boundaries? Vas deferens, testicular artery and peritoneum. Understood? Now look at the screen again. This is the triangle of pain. What is the strangle? Iliopubic tract here, this black line is, you can say inguinal ligament, but from inside they call it iliopubic tract. This is the peritoneum and this is the Tesla artery again. This is triangle of pain. Iliopubic tract, peritoneum and Tesla artery. Why we call it triangle of pain? Because we have four nerves here. And if you apply tacker in a nerve, it will cause pain for months and years to come. So most common nerve injured in open hernia surgery, ilioinguinal, followed by genital branch or genital. But in laparoscopic hernia, most common is lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh here. You must have read Myralgia Paresthesica in Gynae, where sometimes in pregnancy, lateral part of the thigh patient gets pain. Because of this pregnancy, this nerve gets compressed. Lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh. Anterior branch of femoral nerve. Anterior, femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve and femoral nerve. So femoral nerve, anterior branch or lateral cutaneous branch and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. Four nerves are here and they may get injured and they are dark. So what is the triangle of pain boundaries? Iliopubic tract, peritoneum and Tesla artery. What is the triangle of doom boundaries? Vast deferens, Tesla artery and peritoneum. Okay, so this is important. Very frequently asked. Even this year, you had one question on this. In hernia, there were two questions in UPSC and two questions in INICET exam. Two questions. Well, now this is the obturator foramen. This black hole here, having obturator artery. This is the obturator artery. Sometimes we have an aberrant artery connecting obturator artery to inferior here. This is the aberrant artery. This artery will come in our picture in hernia surgery. It may get injured and this can bleed. This is called corona mortis. Accessory obturator, corona mortis, MORTA. Corona is crown and mortis is death. So this artery, which is an aberrant artery, is called corona mortis. Now let me show you some diagram to explain this. You see, in this figure, we have removed fascia, transversalis and peritoneum. So that's why we can see the muscle directly. So this is ASIS. This is pubic tubercle here. This is the superior pubic ramus. And this is the inguinal ligament, black line. Okay. And what about this green thing? This is the lacuna ligament. This is lacuna. So this green. So when we have hernia through lacuna ligament, what do we call this? Laugier hernia. And this is the arcuate line here, posterior sheath. And this is the femoral ring. Let's use another color. We can use maybe violet color. Violet color is not clearly visible. But this is the femoral ring. What are the boundaries of femoral ring? Anteriorly we have, accessory obturator artery, Dagny, correct, is corona mortis. Anteriorly we have inguinal ligament, medially we have lacunar ligament, posteriorly we have pectineus and laterally femoral vessel, femoral vein. Now this triangle you see here, between vast deferens here and inferior and testicular artery here, this triangle is called triangle of doom. And this triangle here is called triangle of pain, right? Let's now, okay. Let's now see another picture, same diagram. This is the inguinal ligament. This is the superior pubic ramus. This is here, black line. This is the lacuna ligament here. This is the femoral ring here. This is femoral ring. This is transversus abdominis muscle and the rectus muscle. RM is rectus. Inferior epigastric artery. So this is the Hasselbalch triangle, the cross. This is the internal ring. What is going in this? Tesla artery, vas and quad structure. This is the bladder. Ye jo gol gol bada sa pada hua peele rang ka ye bladder hai. This is the uracus, which forms median arcuate ligament forming uracus, and this is the lateral umbilical ligament formed by lateral umbilical arteries. So this is the triangle of doom here, and this is the triangle of pain, showing some nerves as well. Tesla artery, here this is vas deferens, VD is vas deferens, this is Tesla artery and this is the peritoneum. Shiv Kumar, I'll answer your question. Don't worry, I'll answer your question. Shiv Kumar, not Shiv Kumar, you are Shiv Kumar. Okay, I'll answer your question. See this diagram, this is your answer. So this is the inguinal ligament, this is the pubic bone, this is the lacunar ligament which is not mentioned here properly. Now this triangle is triangle of doom, vas deferens, distal artery and peritoneum, and this is the triangle of pain, the yellow area. Now look at the screen carefully, Shiv Kumar, this diagram is for you. Can you see this? Abhi bata raha hu, my paternal office. Don't jump from one topic to another. Iske baad wahi bata raha hu. I'm going to that topic after this. So can you see this blue arrow? This artery is connecting obturator artery to inferior epigastric, this artery. So inferior epigastric artery, and it may even connect obturator artery to external iliac. It's possible. It can even connect external iliac or inferior, both. So you cannot say 100% is coming from inferior epigastric. No, it can come from external iliac really, but more often a artery connecting inferior epigastric to obturator is corona mortis, shown by this blue arrow. This is the triangle of pain, this here. What are the boundaries? This is iliopubic tract, this is testicular artery, and this is the peritoneum. Which nerve you see here? Lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh, anterior cutaneous nerve, femoral nerve, and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. Okay? This is a demo, so I'm not going to discuss in detail, but in regular class, we take time and we give you notes and everything, but just to give you an idea, just. Same again, you see the triangle, triangle of doom, triangle of pain, and accessory obturator artery. And what is this green triangle? I'm sure now you can very well answer. This is Hasselbach's triangle for direct hernia. Ab hum aate hain myopectinial orifice, the last point for today, and then one to MCQ, that's it. Dekho, myopectinial orifice is basically the weak area from where all three hernia originate, indirect, direct and femoral. So this is ASIS, this is inguinal ligament. Just look at the screen please for a second. Now I have to draw this pubic bone, we have to go below also. This is the rectus muscle. This is the conjoint tendon here, here. This is the iliosos here. So I am writing CJ, conjoint tendon, and IS, iliosos. This area, this violet area, is myopectinial orifice. From where we will have indirect hernia, direct hernia, femoral hernia. What are the boundaries now? Boundaries are, let me delete this. Boundaries are, just give me a second. Okay. So the boundaries are, So new technology is beyond me actually. It's so idiotic. Anyway, I'll draw it again. So this is the pubic tubercle, pubic bone, rectus muscle, conjoint tendon, iliosos. Sliding hernia, I'll explain Shiv Kumar. Shiv Kumar, you have a wandering kind of fleeting mind, not good. Don't jump from one topic. First understand one topic, then ask. When I'm explaining one thing, you ask another question. And it's for you only. Then I explain that, you ask another question. No, you have to remain focused. When we finish this topic, then ask the next question. I'll give you time. So this wandering kind of you have to do meditation to focus your, you know, thoughts. So Shiv Kumar, this is the lateral border of rectus. Fine. this is the conjoint tendon. For conjoint tendon, I can very well write transverse abdominal central oblique. This is the iliopsoas. This is the pectineus. This is the boundary of myopetal orifice. Anterior, this line, orange line is inguinal ligament, and posterior, this green line is iliopubic tract. So anterior inguinal ligament, posterior iliopubic tract. So you see, let's see this figure. This is rectus, fine. This is conjoint tendon, fine. This is iliopsoas. This is the superior pubic ramus, or you can call pectineal line. This is another myopetal orifice. What are the boundaries? Medially, lateral border of rectus, this. Superiorly, laterally, iliopsoas, this. Inferiorly, bony margin of pelvis, which we can very well write as pectineus or superior pubic ramus. And superiorly, conjoint tendon, this, which it has written, transversus abdominis tendon. So, what are the margin? Let's see in this figure, previous one. Medially, rectus. Laterally, iliopsoas. Superiorly, conjoint tendon. Inferiorly, pubic ramus. Pectineus, fine. So, this is the myopectineal orifice of Froehlich. Fine. I hope you understood. Now, last question. Then I'll tell you starting honey. Yes, starting samjha deta hu. Dekho, this was a question this year. Is saal ye pucha gaya hai. The abdominal hernia, not inguinal, I'm talking of this area here. This hernia here, umbilical hernia epigastric, ventral hernia, laterally iliopsoas, correct. So ventral hernia, we have a European Hernia Society classification. And they have divided it very simply. The question was, what is M3 hernia? M3 was umbilicus. So let me join, explain this to you. So midline and lateral, both hernia, they have come out with a classification. Let's draw, this is umbilicus. Let's draw a line 3 centimeter above and 3 centimeter below. We have drawn a line here, above and below. And then we can draw a line 3 centimeter from here and here. We have made 5 areas. 3 centimeter from lycus either side, 3 centimeter below ziphoid, 3 centimeter above pubic bone. So this is the subziphoid. Okay, I'll show you a diagram so that you understand. My diagram is not very... So, you see, 3 centimeter from the ziphoid, 3 centimeter above the pubic bone. The clinical application, Shivakumar, is that that's a weak area. It does not have strong muscular support. So that's why it does not have proper strength. All hernia, femoral, inguinal and direct, all three hernia, they come from so when we do hernia surgery, if we cover with a mesh the whole myopetal orifice of Froehlich, means this hernia is a good repair. The chances of recurrence are less. So that is the area. Clinical application kya hai iska? Ki iska clinical application ye hai ki this is the site from where all hernia, inguinal, direct, indirect and femoral take place. So this basically how do you draw the line? 3 centimeter below ziphoid sternum, 3 centimeter above pubic bone and 3 centimeter either side of umbilicus. So the 5 zones of M1, M2, M3, M4, M5 are subziphoid here, epigastric here. This whole is umbilicus, infraumbilical and suprapubic. Subziphoid, epigastric, supraumbilical, infraumbilical, infraumbilical and suprapubic. So M3 hernia is a umbilical hernia. And what is umbilical hernia? Not coming out from umbilicus. 3 centimeter, this is the Ames question, that umbilical hernia includes 3 centimeter on either side of umbilicus. You see, and then they have a lateral classification also, lateral to rectus muscle, L1, L2, L3, that is also by 3 centimeter. So L1 is subcostal, L2 is flank, L3 is iliac and L4 is lumbar. So you see, this is a classification. Just a minute, I wanted to show you a diagram. You see, on Facebook I posted a photo of umbilical hernia. Why it's important? In laparoscopic hernia repair, we make a port through the umbilicus for camera, 10 millimeter port. Any incision 10 millimeter or more through the rectus should be closed. Patient can develop hernia. Below 10 millimeter, no problem. But above 10 millimeter or 10 millimeter, he can develop it. So because we make a port through the umbilicus in laparoscopic surgery, if we do not properly close that port, patient can develop hernia through that particular port. And this is a M3 hernia, umbilical hernia. So last week only I saw a patient in my OPD. He underwent laparoscopic osteotomy in 2016 in South Delhi Hospital. So I took a photo of that and I posted it on Facebook. So I wanted to show you that photo, but probably it's not in this thumb drive. Let me check. No, it's not here. Sorry, it's not here. So basically umbilical hernia is M3 hernia, right? So this is M1. What is M1? Gilbert-Nyhasa classification. Yeah, you have to remember Nyhasa classification. You have to remember Nyhasa, not Gilbert-Nyhasa. So M1 is subxiphoid, M2 is epigastric, M3 is umbilical, M4 is infraumbilical, and M5 is suprapubic, right? Now coming to sliding hernia. Shivakumar, last point for you. Otherwise, I would have closed now. This is the one question you have asked, so I'm going to answer this question. You see, what's sliding hernia? Not sliding hernia of GIT, of sliding, rolling, and paraesophageal. No, not that hernia, hiatus hernia. It's inguinal hernia. Dekho kya hota hai? This is the, now watch carefully and listen carefully. This is the internal ring. This is the external ring. This is the inguinal canal. The peritoneum is coming out from, this is the cord structure. And peritoneum shown by blue color is coming out like this. Fine, no problem. Now, whatever content is here in the abdominal cavity, like bowel or omentum, can definitely follow this pleural sac, and that will become a content of hernia. Now, what happens, like omentocele or enterocele, what happens if the internal ring is very wide? This is the sac, peritoneum sac forming the hernia, sac, not cord, sac. And this whole tissue, what is this yellow areas? Extraperitoneal area, they also start protruding through the internal ring. They can become a part of hernia, but they can never become a content of the sac because they were not inside the abdominal cavity from the very beginning. They are extraperitoneal structure. What are these extraperitoneal structure? On the right side, this is bladder. So bladder can come here. This is cecum. Cecum can come here. So they will form a wall of the sac. They will not become a content of the sac. And so when extraperitoneal structure, they also slide through the internal ring, forming the wall of the sac. Then we call it sliding hiatus hernia. And what all structure can slide down? Right side laterally cecum. Medially bladder, left side medially bladder, left side laterally sigmoid colon. So I don't have to write the sigmoid, we know here, and cecum we know here. So cecum, bladder, sigmoid. And they form by the side of sac, forming the wall of the sac, going through the internal ring, becoming a part of hernia. Then this is called sliding hiatus hernia, or another name is hernia in glissade. Okay? So this is the concept of sliding hiatus hernia. I hope you have understood. Why weight lifting is not a risk factor for hernia according to latest Love and Belly? Well, weight lifting is a risk factor if the anatomy is distorted. Shivakumar, I'll change your question. I'll ask another question. In congenital hernia, we do herniotomy. You know what is herniotomy? Herniotomy means only ligating the sac at the internal ring. No kind of repair, tissue repair, mesh repair, nothing is done. So why only the ligation of sac and the internal ring will suffice without any repair in herniotomy in children? Because the strength of the inguinal canal comes from the muscle, and this, of course, the rings are important, but the canal has obliquity. Obliquity means it's not straight, it's oblique. It's oblique like this. Internal ring here, external ring here. So when we increase the abdominal pressure, and at the same time, muscle is also contracting. So they press the whole area, and now the risk of hernia become less. So in children, the inguinal canal is straight, but with age, with growth spurt, when they grow, it become oblique. So muscle obliquity will come with time, and that will support the inguinal canal, and that will prevent hernia. I mean, no strength, no weakness is there, so no repair is required. So that is why if I increase the intra-abdominal pressure, and my muscles are strong. So pressure is increasing, at the same time muscles are contracting and they squeeze the inguinal canal. That's why the risk of hernia is less. But after all, so in abdominal pressure, high, muscle is also contracting in weightlifting. That's why, but this is a wrong statement that it's not a risk factor. Like in old age, when I increase the abdominal pressure and muscle become weak, then definitely it will become a risk factor. So in old age, if I start lifting the weight and without taking protection of the inguinal area, then of course patient will develop a hernia. So it all depends on the muscle strength. Okay, so this is about the simple anatomy. Any question you have? So you see this and all the lectures, all the faculties must be telling you the features they will have in this app, Ultimate. We'll cover the whole lecture. We will have lectures from 5 days in a week. Saturday, Sunday will be off from 5 to 9 or 5 to 10. So, and we will cover all the subjects in about 30 weeks time. So all the, and you'll get the benefit of grand test and subject wise test and all those. So all the important features, salient features, the incentives and the benefit of this app, I'm sure must have been told to you many times. What is Ogilvy syndrome? What is Ogilvy hernia? Arre bhai. Ogilvy syndrome is intestinal pseudo obstruction. I mean to say, well, it's not a test, the doubt solving session, so this is the last question, then I'll stop. What is Ogilvy syndrome? It is in a pseudo obstruction of colon. You see what happens, the parasympathetic, they increase the motility and sympathetic, they suppress the motility. So whenever there's an imbalance, parasympathetic suppression, sympathetic stimulation, the motility is affected. There's no anatomical obstruction. No anatomical obstruction. But colon loses it's a physiological obstruction of colon. That's what's called pseudo obstruction. So transition zone is between midgut and hindgut, that's somewhat at the spinal flexure area, and the colon keeps on distending. Finally, it distends so much that patient can develop gangrene. More common in old patient after minor trauma, minor surgery, and sometimes spontaneous also. So Ogilvy syndrome and neostigmine is the drug of choice, and keep the colon collapse. Don't let it distend. Otherwise, patient will develop gangrene. So, देखो बहुत सारे जो हर्निया के टाइप्स हैं, बहुत सारे टाइप्स, एटलीस्ट 25 रेयर टाइप्स ऑफ हर्निया, वी विल डिस्कस दैट इन रेगुलर, बहुत सारे टाइप्स हैं, आई डिस्कस ऑल ऑफ देम इन रेगुलर बैच. सो आई थिंक आई स्टॉप नाउ एंड जस्ट टू गिव यू अ जिस्ट ऑफ द बेनिफिट ऑफ लाइव लेक्चर, दिस दैट वाज द पर्पस ऑफ दिस लेक्चर. सो चलो बंद करते हैं, ठीक है. अंकित, खुशी, हर्षिता एंड अवस्थी, दिशा, थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू टू sparing time joining. Indragni, Sapan Mai chala gaya hai kyunki usne nahi likha kuch bhi. And Shiv Kumar who came late, I'm sure. Disha, chalo, okay. So good night, all the best to all of you. We'll stop now.